Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Lake on Fire by Rosellen Brown. Read by Emily Lawrence. I carry a brick on my shoulder in order that the world may know what my house was like. Bertolt Brecht. We must admit there will be music, despite everything. Jack Gilbert. 1. For all the years of her life, this was the story Chaya Liebe told. The missing parts stayed missing. There were many brothers and sisters Shadorovsky, but Chaya Liebe loved Asher best, 1,000 times best. He was her only vanity. She was the oldest sister. Between them, there were 6. Yaakov, Beriel, Binyamin, Yitzhak, the Vorele, and Masha. And, in 2 different graveyards, the large one there, in Zitomir, and the fresh one here, in Christo, Wisconsin, a few more, souls shaken out of them like seeds from a burst pot, early or late. The only one lost in the new land was Sorle, who, as a baby, just learning to walk, caught a fever that almost killed the rest of them. She was one of the helpless pioneers of the stone-hard graveyard, out in the fenced place, as far from the barn and the house as they could take her. The first act a community of Jews must perform, even before they build a place to pray, is to make a burial ground and fence it away from unhallowed soil. They understand the priorities of the universe too well to be frivolous. The children's mother was brusque to them all, so busy they remembered her mainly as motion, sewing, darning, cooking, planting, sweeping, all the ing words. Her hands flashing faster than barn swallows. There wasn't much left of her for loving, although they knew that the motion was somehow meant for them. Chaya was the one who, back in the grim city where they were born, caught Asher's first word. 2 words, actually, spoken clearly at 6 months, while their mother dozed over his nursing. It's Gertelt. Or so her mother heard it. Gertelt? She gasped back at him, rudely awakened. Her nipple, abandoned, quivered like a lip before tears. Shine! Finished. Chaya tried to console her mother. She had been a smoother, a reassurer, a peace bringer from the first day she discovered discord. It was a treasure and a fault. This desperation she felt to rush ahead of anyone headed for a painful confrontation, to cushion the blow about to land, whether out of kindness or out of her own need to be loved, in gratitude. Mother, she whispered, looking regretfully at the basket into which her baby brother had been thrust to quell his thirst alone. Mother, sweet. Which she was not. Little mama. But she saw the way the affront misted her mother's eyes. Who was this Asher? Stranger than any of her other children. He was the most curious child who ever lived, Chaya understood. And he became, early, early, a little mill for grinding words into questions. A memorizer, a challenger, a declarer. It was not her mother's imagination that he seemed to have been born talking. He was never still and never silent. Get a vic, she would shout at him. Go away, and swat at him as if he were a horsefly. Silent herself, Chaya was glad to give him her ear. She loved them both. So, in a single gesture, Asher had been weaned. and in spite of Chaya's placating murmur, his mother never forgave him. He seemed to have slipped between this year's pages of Who Shall Live and Who Shall Die as a special case, larger than mere life, exempt from all that burdened the rest of them into ordinariness. Asher was not relatively astonishing. He was an absolute. Still, condemned to crawl on a cold Russian floor in the lee of the drafts that came in under their door. His genius was not, except to his sister, cause for celebration. And now, they lived in a place called Krista in the state of Wisconsin. A joke, such a name for a pack of disheveled Jews, some of whom swayed and prayed, others of whom blasphemed. The pathetic piece of land they lived on, 17 of them, before the addition of any new life, or the subtraction of old, had been assigned by the powers of the Hebrew Emigrant Assistance Society, with the best of intentions and a dangerous optimism. The association's clerks moved pins randomly on their map as the hordes poured by the thousands out of the pale, ahead of or behind the pogroms, the empty stomachs, the laws and the threats and the curses. Undoubtedly, they looked at their maps with satisfaction. They were not making exiles. They were making Americans. Chayaliba was 14, newly arrived at the age of self-consciousness when they left Zhytomyr. She would forever remember their arrival with feelings of exhilaration turned to shame. How Asher came leaping down the narrow stairs of the SS Stettin into the crypt called steerage, slipping on the damn floor, clinging to the walls, shouting, "We're here! They're coming in! Everybody on deck! Schnell! Schnell!" Her brother was now 8, small, lithe, with slanted gray eyes that looked for action wherever he could find it. Movement, sparking energy, and danger if there was any to be found. One of those boys fueled by risk. He had a map of ringworm on his scalp that had eaten his spiky hair away in a spiral. His eyes, when he yelled at his family to hurry, were as round as the portholes no one in steerage had so much as glimpsed. He blinked them rapidly, signals of his earnestness, and was gone. And so they hurried. They washed themselves off as best they could without much water. Mothers showing the way to children and straightened their stringy hair that they had sweated in for weeks, adjusted their clothes. Chaya's thick dress smelled vaguely of vomit and, worse, not even hers. And as if it were Shabbos, and they were rising into its light and sweetness, trusting, they rushed up the many narrow sets of stairs, single file, to crowd against the rail. The air was so thick with fog it beaded up on the steel sides of the ship, making the rivets shine. Their mother had one fist over her heart, the way she did on Yom Kippur, when she beat her breast for her sins. "Oh Lord, let it not be London," she muttered to herself. She could never alarm her children on purpose. She had heard of cases where a family bought a ticket to New York and found itself dumped with frightening finality on the dock in Liverpool or London, duped by the agent and out of luck. In America, father had said and said again, in public and alone, they encourage Jews to be people of substance, not only the people of the book, which doesn't feed their children. Here we will take care of ourselves, eating from our own crops, owing nothing, working with our animals. Though no one had animals in Zhytomyr, no one had crops. It was not even a shtetl, with a concave cow and yards full of geese, ruling ourselves without fear of pogrom or famine. We will support ourselves cleanly and healthily, not in the city and not in the village, which everyone knows is a foul sty, a blight of dependent paupers.
"Fievel," she had heard him say, "every town is a fievel like ours, or a velvel, or a yossel, who sits on a box at the corner of our street. The most decrepit of beggars, a walking swarm of flies, an animated rag pile. Is that what we want the world to see when they see a Jew?"
Chayaliba would listen, a little moonily, respecting and slightly fearing the avid swell in his voice.
"Now imagine Fievel sitting on a bench beneath an apple tree, watching his sheep graze."
She knew Fievel. He was lazy. He was inept. He might even be a little bit mad. But that was not the point here. It was the saving balm of the barnyard her father wanted them to think about, when the mysteries of the farm still seemed simple to unmystify and master. He himself was a bookbinder, adept at intricate finger movements, which, though the work kept his hands busy, left his mind and his mouth free for endless political debate. In another world, he could have been a senator, possibly a journalist. In his world, he was only a dreamer, which meant that his wife worked harder than he did to keep his family in herring and stale heels of bread.
"And when we arrive, the Americans will meet us with a band,"
the dreamer assured them.
"This I have heard."
Ah, he could be persuasive. She ought to have asked where he had heard it. But even had she doubted, she would not have dared.
"Trumpets and a drum?"
one of them asked, smiling, and he said yes, really.
"And with flowers. They will give us tools and the animals we will need to start our new life, and bring us in a wagon and show us to our own spot of clean dirt."
His father, their grandfather, had farmed a piece of a peasant's land illegally and had been stripped of his goods, beaten in the farmyard by the Tsar's inspectors and laughed down the road and out of sight, long before their father was born. To be a farmer, legally. But the children had to wonder what he meant by clean dirt, the planting dirt he promised. Their mother and Chaya and the other girls had enough trouble keeping the house straight, swept, swabbed. There was no such thing as dirt that was not an affliction. But their father tended to be right most of the time. A wise family did not separate its hopes from its father's. Up on the deck, Zanville the Hatter had the flag. He had kept it standing up out of the muck. He wore a smile so wide, his stubbled cheeks crushed up under his eyes while he struggled to pull the flag loose from its carefully tied binding of rags. Then, with a flourish, he shook it out, and it sent a sharp report like the crack of a gun. It was a moment they had dreamed of. There it was, still crisp and clean, never yet used in the real world that preceded this dream. Om Olam, carefully embroidered in gold upon a red field. Below that, all 10 commandments, the sewn letters tiny as ants, and a plow standing by itself, waiting to be seized, its two handles wide as the horns of a barnyard bull. Across the bottom, the words, proud and square, in a Yiddish with grand serifs. Arise from the dust, throw off the contempt of the nations, for the time has come. Zanville, having protected the flag from Zitomir to Hamburg, to their ship, was the one they chose to hold it up. They raised their fists and cheered and shouted and made a happy racket, this unspeakable journey almost done. The children jumped so that they could come down hard and noisily on the damp deck. Zanvil was wagging the banner in the fumy air, gold on red, a rag of color against a cloud, and all of them were cheering when a man in a dark blue uniform and a hat, he looked rather like a trolley man, but did not carry himself like one, poked through the rows with a face like a hard fist made for bruising. What, he demanded none too nicely, were they doing? No, what did they think they were doing, as if they just might be misinformed? Between them, as it happened, there was no more than a thimbleful of English, but because Zanvil had already been in America before,
in Baltimore,
and returned in a fury, full of himself, when his wife threatened to divorce him if he stayed away a minute longer, so they heard when their mother spoke in her gossip voice, he was able to say something about celebration and, perhaps badly put, the land. The land, he said. Something about taking over the land. Am Olam means people of the earth. It must have seemed that he dragged his words under the man's nose like cat scent to a dog. He meant 10 acres, a fence, a barn. The official repeated Zanvil's last words with astonishment. Take over the land? By the descending movement of his hands, they could see that he was ordering Zanvil to lower the flag. Couldn't they? Couldn't they?
No,
Zanvil said. He was a squat man, amiable, hairy as a hound. Now, though, he looked like a small guard dog ineptly preventing passage.
Or else,
the man threatened.
This is a free country. That is why we are here.
Zanvil flung at him. Something like that, although not comprehensibly. The crowd tried to make taunting noises in their own language, or halfway in it, in something they took for the sound of democracy, in which they knew they were free to say anything they pleased. The trolley man's face deepened a few shades, and a cord beat in his forehead as if it were counting off time. Under a wide mustache, he bit his lip, considering. Then, like a school child, with an awful sound, he lunged at Zanvil, whose cap flew off over the rail as if it were a shot bird, and floated for a while till it picked up the weight of the water. Then it sank. They tussled for a moment or two. The rest of the men cried out in anguish and leaned in to try to help, but they were afraid to be too bold. The women simply shrieked, and the trolley man managed to seize the broomstick that was the pole of the flag, bang it angrily against the shiny rail to try to break it in half, then, in frustration, raise it over his head, whole, and fling it, as hard as he could, into the white wake of the ship. It came down slowly and spread itself out for just an instant like a tablecloth. A fancy Shabbos cloth against the dirty greenish spume. Arise from the, and one horn of the plow, and then, whipped into a frenzy of bubbles and shreds, it was dragged under the body of the ship and down. He smoothed his mustache with both his forefingers, restoring his dignity as if he were soothing it. There, there. Then he nodded curtly at the rest of them and disappeared behind a curtain of fog. So much for the flowers and the plows. Chaya was afraid to look at her father. Blame and its suppression would come later. Now she wanted so devoutly to go home that she'd have been grateful, would have borne another 2 weeks of stink and turmoil gladly, if the ship were to turn and make for Hamburg, to return them to Europe, all of them safe. The vibration that had thrummed under her feet as steadily as a heartbeat had broken off for good, and she was overcome with panic laced with disappointment, and another layer beneath that, a roiling anger for which she had no words. 2. Was there a biblical curse that promised 5 years of squalor, spoilage, and rot? They called themselves the Fields of Zion, and, for all their hope, they came naked to their future. Native-born farmers from Massachusetts, from New York and Vermont, flowing westward on a river of restlessness and ambition, faced every cruelty of nature, but not innocence. At least, they were familiar with the soil, with animals. They knew how to build. But the Fields of Zion farmers were gray-faced and weak-fingered from too many years in a murderous city. Their lungs were coated with factory smoke, their minds fixed either on a book full of holy exhortations, O Lord our God, be gracious unto thy people Israel, and accept their prayer. Remember us this day for our good, and be mindful of us for a life of blessing. O, may our eyes witness thy return to Zion. Or, on the socialist mission to undermine all that and blame forces equally abstract for every evil. None had ever stood behind a plow or seen hail flatten a greening field. Their first bewildering night, fresh from Castle Garden and an endless train ride, they had slept in a field in one large circle, feet toward the center, like the spokes of a wheel. They managed to find a sawmill and, with no English, bought wood, more costly than they had expected, and built the fewest buildings possible. Given the cost of pine, the commons, one large building, was going to have to suffice for a very long time. Each family had a single, porous-walled room. The wood that had been loosely assembled was so green it still bled sap. In time, great rivulets ran down its surface like those marvelous paintings of the Madonna that weep miraculous tears. It rejected nails, actually gobbled them into ragged holes that meant that no one could hang any ornament or picture without quickly discovering it in a tangle on the tilting floor. Then, not counting two outbuildings, one for men and one for women, so that modesty could remain at least technically unbreached, came a barn, leaky and canted, and finally a chicken coop that the chickens avoided when they could, never confiding the source of their dissatisfaction. Chaya was repelled by the spectacle of her respected elders reduced to gawking children, inept and unprepared. She could not forget the trolley man cursing at the little crowd as they huddled on the fog-bound deck. What must he have been saying in that language she knew not more than three words of? Hello and thank you, assiduously practiced in her bunk. Go home? We don't need your kind here? Whatever it was he shouted when he ruined the flag, at that moment, were they cursed? How else could the end have been written at the very beginning? She was a girl from a gray and stony city. When she studied the Field of Zion's buildings thrown up quickly, crookedly, by the light of their faith that such approximate carpentry would hold, and then the chicken coop when their birds spent too much time hiding, still, she was glad they had not been turned back to Hamburg. Unpainted, gray as the sky, the building seemed to be riding an ocean of green. When the wind blew, and it did, viciously, without barrier, the long grasses danced like surf, swaying, bowing, miraculously recovering, just to be leveled again. She was bewitched by a beauty she had never seen, the fat spread of raindrops on the doorstep, the sweet smell, better than warming dough, that rose from the damp ground. There was such a promise of peace here, and safety. Empty space without a shadow on it. She had never really seen the horizon before. Perhaps she could be happy here. But there was work to be done, and bills to pay from the little they'd been given. A small packet alongside their train tickets. The building sometimes swayed in the wind when the cold poked through the walls, over the sills. It whistled, a thin sound like an unattended kettle. Slowly, slowly, the ship began to list and take on water. Chaya began to feel it, one worry at a time. The hens were either very dumb or very smart. They left their eggs, some but not all, in the low bushes outside their coop. Either the coop was all wrong, built badly somehow, its sills already splintering, and they preferred to nest in the dead leaves on the ground, or they were being clever and having a good morning laugh. But when she came with her basket looking for the eggs, it wasn't funny. Hollering at them didn't help. Not only do they not tend to be clever, but one did not reason with chickens. The cows were bad milkers. There were two, called Ein and Zwei, one and two, because in a muddle of tradition, someone had insisted that giving them human names would insult the memory of a departed soul who had happened to share that name.
"Do you say Gadish for a cow?"
Zanvil it was. Zanvil the Hatter. The cow pond, coated with scum like fat on soup. Only this soup could not be skimmed. There was no clean water for a mikveh, which tormented those who cared. The women monthly, the men before holidays and holy events. You were supposed to immerse yourself completely, over your head, your hair slicked. But if you did that in the cow pond, you came up cobwebbed with green silt and mucus weed, reeking like foul breath. No honor to God or self in that. The dry rows of growing greens, stunted, crooked, choked. Nothing burgeoned, nothing spread, little flowered. Tomatoes hung riddled with wormholes, hard and pale pink. Lettuce bolted before it could thrive. Onions went dead in the ground, their green flags browning from heat and lack of rain. Rusted tools, bought used, cheap, but a bad bargain. The wheels of the blue wagon did not match. Every trip, sitting in the remnants of hay, clots of manure on her boots, she rattled so badly she came unstrung and quivered like an old woman the rest of the day. The horse, poor ratchety horse, reorganized the flies with a frayed tail and watched her smooth her dress and try for dignity after a ride like that. And then there were the others. Yenim, some Chaya loved. Toiba with her kind, kind face. Uri, the jokester. Others were either too pious. Pesya and Zanvil, Mordechai, who had no wife. Lazer and Itzach, who fasted Mondays and sometimes Thursdays and, famished, could not work. Or simply, Meshuga, too crazy for this world. Mutl spoke to no one. Bunya was a secret drinker, but not so secret that he didn't tip over tables, fall asleep in the snow to be found by the bony old dog, weep, loom, cower. Why did nothing thrive in this place? Whom could she ask? She could not ask her mother and father because they had chosen this, or at least chosen the idea of it. She seethed at the casual way in which the men from HEAS, upstairs at Castle Garden, pink-skinned, clean-scrubbed Germans, who handled them with their fingertips like dirty laundry, had sent them forth, no questions asked, with no support but that small wallet of cash and no instruction. She was not quite a child, not quite an adult, when she'd heard someone say, "Beginnings are more than beginnings. They make the next things happen the way they do." She was older now, and she did not like the way those next things were happening. As for her affinity with a cher, he was a born provocateur. Communal life created the flimsiest of separations, boundaries, borders, and it seemed that if anyone spoke so much as a word, a cher could hear it and, made irritable by discretion, retell it to anyone who would listen. He did not hesitate to invade a privacy. Pessia, round as a wheel of cheese, stock still in her undergarments.
"Do you know, the fat hangs down off her arms, is like candle drippings."
Mutal at prayer alone, hiding out when the mignon needed a tenth man. Each sock pinching the cows and secretly tormenting Schlepper, their pathetic horse. It was Asher's curiosity that pulled him along. He wanted to know everything. One night, he saw Rivka and Munya huddled in the shadows of the barn, very close together, face to face. Attached, in fact. They were mouth to mouth, and he could hear them breathing.
"Why are you doing that?"
his small voice. They fell away from each other and stared at him and ran behind the barn. He saw Batya beating her child with a mixing spoon, holding her by her hair and swinging her high and wide while the little girl shrieked. Again his voice, undaunted.
"Stop! Stop! You are making her bleed!"
When he saw these things, these and more, the secret hoard of extra food that Mordechai hid under his bedclothes, the way Reuven slept behind a hay bale instead of swinging his scythe. Petty, they were, but he told them all to Chaya.
"Shh," she soothed. "Those are not things you ought to be seeing." "But they're true."
He could look quite petulant. He stared her down.
"I saw them."
"They may be true, but people do not want to hear them, Asher.
Adults," she amended.
"Adults do not appreciate being talked to that way by a child." "Do you want to hear the kind of hens we have?"
He didn't wait for an invitation. Listing the things he knew, miscellaneous, was as natural to him as running and wrestling were to the others.
"Leghorns, Rhode Island Reds, Araucanas, Barred Rocks, 2 Lanctions, and 1 Australorp."
There were no words for these in Yiddish. They made an indecipherable sentence.
"How do you know those?"
She didn't ask why he wanted to know them, which he probably couldn't answer.
"I listen. I like to listen."
He clapped his hands. Modesty was a far reach for a cher, as impossible as silence. For a boy his age, he still had the kind of little ears, far forward, that make babies irresistible. His skin was tender, and though his features were sweet and regular and promised a later lifetime of dangerously good looks, now his eyes were almost perfectly round, and his hair stood up stiff as a whisk broom, the hair newborns lose in their first weeks. In his intensity, he did look the far side of peculiar. His mother still looked wary around him. She gave him a wide berth. Chaya watched him kick at the pebbles under his feet, watched him try to resolve to cease his judgments on everything he saw. But his conscience was his curse. She knew he would fail.
"Oh, a cher! Getzele!"
Kitten. Or no, not kitten. Rather, little cat, which is something different. The animal mature, but miniature. She could not imagine what kind of adult he would make, but she suspected he would not have it easy. 3. Small fires flared between the opposed houses. The socialists, who observed no ritual, constrained themselves from jeering and contributed their bodies to be counted in the mignon. In return, the zealous religionists, not cheerfully, refrained from carrying on like prophets in the town square of Sodom. For the most part, they left each other's souls alone. But very early, Zanville the Hatter and Mordechai disappeared for a week, gone to Milwaukee to purchase a Torah, which they had laboriously located via a series of letters to names they had gleaned who knows how. They returned triumphant, the heavy hand-lettered scroll swaddled in blankets so that it looked like a child protected from a snowstorm. Once back, they confronted the fury of the half of the fields of Zion that had never been consulted about, such a waste of the colony's slim resources. The battle lines were drawn. How dare the godless work on the days of awe? Shabbos was bad enough, but the most profound of ceremonial days?
Do the cows stop giving milk?
Father demanded.
Do the hens refrain from laying in honor of the day?
The children stood at the door when their screaming parents confronted one another, fully expecting them to fall upon each other like dogs. But, too, there were joyous days. The commons had seen one marriage. The couple Asher had discovered behind the barn. Rivka, the very young daughter, and Munya, the son of cousins, had arrived indifferent to each other, but had discovered an affinity during the blank days and nights of their first Wisconsin winter. Almost at once, Rivka was blooming with a bellyful of child. And there was a good bit of dancing in the commons, single sex and not, Mordechai wielding a tolerable violin. High spirits drove the dancers, women flattered by the temporary attention of their husbands, even if they could not touch. Children lifted and swung, shrieking. Melodies swelled with longing and loss. Sweet songs floated into the chill, goyish Wisconsin air, crying out to those left behind across the ocean. 4. The fathers of some of the children chose to teach them Torah and Talmud and leave the learning of English to chance. Somewhere along the way, between there and here, they had lost heart and were not so eager now to transform their children into Americaners. Might they not, if they mixed with the local stock at the schoolhouse, be taught forbidden subjects like Christmas and hymn singing? Might they be offered a bite off the haunch of a pig at lunchtime? A guzzle of milk after the poisonous meat? So the children stayed moored out there on that dusty road with starving animals and scrappy harvests, bored when they were not working, bored when they were, taught in whatever stray, idle moment occurred, neither there nor here. The adults needed someone, though, who could be a courier to the world, someone to interpret, to speak for them, and in spite of her sober silence, or perhaps because it made her seem scholarly, a girl of moderating temperament, double-sided. They consulted and considered and finally chose Chaya. She was so often the conciliator between antagonists, they were convinced she would be the best one to walk with a foot in each language, each life. For as long as it took her to drink down her new language and, nourished, make new bone with it, English her stepmother tongue, she walked the very long way into town and into the whitewashed schoolhouse. There she sat at a desk too small for her, her knees pushed tight up against rough boards, so that she could learn what the littlest ones were learning, those shapes and sounds, those capitals of the world, those numbers.
Chaya? What kind of name is that?
Asked a girl smaller than she, who stood with one shoulder cocked like a dare. They had said hello to her the day she first appeared, but when she told them her name, they laughed. "It's Chaya," she said, exaggerating the throat scratch. "Ch," that gargle, not "g." She tried looking straight at the girl who was half her size to protect her pride.
"Ugh, you sound like you're going to spit."
Her own "ch" passable, still, the girl made a disgusted face. Chaya stood eyes wide, lips parted.
"Yes, like zit, like ugh,"
she wanted to say, but could not. Boys fought with their fists. Girls mocked. She swallowed her defense. Impatient, they turned their backs and left her standing in her pool of silence. Something stubborn, dignity for which she had no word, kept her from approaching them again. There was a German boy in the school as well, but he and the other boys didn't worry his chus. They shared wordless pleasures without difficulty, threw rocks at birds, squashed frogs and grasshoppers, chased the girls around the lilac bush that stood in the middle of the scuffed-up yard. She had not expected it to be easy. Could someone be born lonely? Chaya wondered. The possibility did not leave her feeling bereft. She looked at it, rather, with a consoling dispassion. Like so much else, it was simply a question she had no one to ask. Like her brother, she had been an infant early full of words. She could still make herself remember what it felt like to learn them. Those hummed mms behind a closed mouth, the ticklish glottals and fricatives, shh, like a wind brushing forward from the back of her throat. Endless experiment, a sensual feast for herself alone. It was an ecstasy to blow and click and suck in, then try the sounds in dozens of shapes, and then, after a while, know they formed words she could use to make herself understood. But that was the old language. Now she had to move her mouth in a dozen new directions, suppress the sounds she had lived in, pick out of the welter of noise vowels she had never heard before. A musical scale with intervals she could barely discern. Walking home from the schoolhouse, she said them over and over again, sang them like a song no one could hear. Or no, they were a prayer, and she was a convert who had to learn them. But her tongue would not cooperate. This, not this, was the hardest. This, there, theirs. Not oi, but o. O, o, and o again. If only someone at home could listen and know when she got things wrong. A chair pulling at her sleeve begged,
"Talk to me in that English, Chai. I want to talk it too."
And she was not surprised. He learned it faster than she could bring him words. Her teacher, impressed with the speed of her learning, slipped books to Chaya on her way out the door. Jane Eyre, which was not easy to parse. Wuthering Heights, which inflamed her like a forbidden dream. Romantic novels, ladies' books in which strong-willed women broke themselves on the rack of society's demands but justified their capitulation. All for love. They were always beautiful or, with love, became so. They were always good. She wished she could speak with someone about their fates, these heroines of Mrs. Humphrey Ward, of Frances Marion Crawford, of Chester Bailey Fernald, whose major challenge was which man, among two opposing types, to marry. Her teacher, for all the generosity of the loan of her library, frightened her. Though many schoolmistresses were barely older than their charges, Miss Singlet was a very thin, straight-spined older lady. She seemed to have been compressed, as if in a vice, and the striped skirt she favored made her look even longer, like a candy cane. Unmarried, monocled, she did not appear to be the woman to interpret these passions for Chaya. Nor did her own mother, so work-worn, so respectful of her husband, but voiceless. Then one day, Chaya made the mistake of reciting for her parents a poem she had learned in school. She thought that the English that now poured easily off her tongue would make them proud.
Announced by all the trumpets of the sky, arrives the snow, and driving o'er the fields, seems nowhere to alight.
It was what they wanted of her. Obliging them had been bliss, though it hadn't been easy. It had simply strained her capacity for empathy to be isolated from both sets of companions, at home and in the little schoolhouse. She had won the oratorical competition with the poem and had been given a whole book of verse called Pillows to Dream On for a prize. She allowed herself to be dramatic as it hurried to its close, because it made her feel like someone other than herself.
Stone by stone, built in an age, the mad wind's nightwork, the frolic architecture of the snow.
Beaming, her mother applauded, her father banged his mug on the pine table, and she felt, perhaps for the first time, that her voice had carried forth into the world her true feelings.
That is a fine way,
father said, looking hard at her, his frank face above his mustache red with pleasure.
To end your time at school, we were right to send you, of all the children.
She was confused.
Now that you have learned so much, you can help us when we need to speak in town, and you can come back to work here at home, where we need you.
She argued. She wept. She was not competent at this work. She did not care about this work. It made no sense. Chaya loved her parents and felt for their difficulties. Her mother breathed for them. She was their pulsing machine. She admired her father for the dignity of his commitments. He was a man who bled for others, who ought to have been given a chance to work for the well-being of strangers. But they were living someone else's life. She was certain of that. Driven to improve their chances, they had chosen wrong and were covered with the dust of failing farmers. They seemed to attract catastrophe. The rain that soaked the hay before they got it in, the calf that strangled in the womb and could not be pulled out until its poor mother expired. The wind, so harsh it could not be measured, that took down the chimney pipe and let the rain flood in and soak the quilts and bother the babies. Each, if you traced it back a few steps, was the result of their incompetence. And luck. Luck was nothing but their enemy. By now, too, she had heard of other ventures all too much like this one, sent by HEAS to Dakota where they froze, to Louisiana where they flooded and died of yellow fever. Only a few in New Jersey, less than laughable. Even those had to hire themselves to the factories of New York. They tilled and planted and harvested after hours, and how could they not have broken under the burden of their double work lives? So much optimism undone. So much energy wasted.
You are ready for the academy,
her father told her.
But the academy costs money we can't spare.
He sipped weak tea, no sugar cube between his teeth, because white sugar also cost money.
Do you think we enjoy the load we lift? The bending, the carrying, the calluses on our hands? Why do you think you can exempt yourself?
He looked at her gravely.
We are doing this for each other.
She breathed in deeply and then dared to say to him,
We should never have come.
It was the first time she had not run to apply a salve of absolution before she struck. The worst of it was that he knew she was right. He looked back at her with a harshness she could see he was trying to contain and joined his hands together as if they could squeeze back words he did not want to say. Just as well. She would not have liked any response he could give her. Asher was the only one who saw her disappointment. The others would hate her for thinking herself superior. In Zitomir, everything lay ahead. In another country. She had had enough of the horizon. In Krista, she dreamed of the city. Why could she own not a single fine dress so that she was condemned to wear her poor, faded school dress to the oratorical competition? In spite of its difficulty, she had loved going to her school because each new thing she learned promised to be useful for her next step. Reading those books to be diverted from boredom, but also to lay down a road that she might travel. She had bent her head over the times tables, each combination a different shade in her mind. For some reason, 11 times 11 amused her. 12 times 12 felt solid and round and reassuring. But chiefly, numbers would be necessary to calculate her way. Someday, to independence. Pared to the bone by skimpy diet and endless labor, she could feel fury bubbling like a caustic, burning everything away but hope. She was going to correct the mistake that was her life as soon as the moment came clear. She had never before deliberately hurt someone. She was prepared for regret. In the meantime, she woke up one morning with a plan. Passivity. Refusal, like a stone, many sharp little stones in her palm, clutched but not thrown. She would grow calluses to blunt her pain. Against every instinct, she was going to render herself useless. If they would not give her what she needed, she would not give them anything at all. And if she became a burden, wouldn't they expel her? Instead of pulling the peas off their spiraling vines and then shelling them into the pail, where the first layer made a pinging sound like rain against tin, she hid beneath the farthest tree in the orchard, reading Mrs. Dancy's Fortune, another story of a girl who, finally, for all her early spirit, does as she must, as others demand. And smiles prettily in her arbor. Miss Singlet had wanted to lend her a very big volume called Moby Dick, but wondered if she could manage it. She would make herself manage it. She did not come when called. When her mother handed her a basket of laundry to take to the pond, she turned her back and walked away, hoping her desperation would finally convince them to set her free. She ate sullenly beside them, meals she had not helped cook, and when the dishes were ready to be cleared and washed, she vanished without a word of apology, walked off across the low rows of green shoots she had not planted. She was appalled at her insolence and thrilled by her daring. Her mother called down a choleria on her, cholera, an all too familiar curse, and prayed that her disobedient feet would wither. Chaya, clenched tight so as not to be too badly hurt, smiled to hear it. Her poison was working its way. She closed her eyes and let the stunning curses fall on her head. They looked at her with contempt. No one understood what she was doing. Only Asher could console her. Sometimes their bond was uncanny. Chaya would think something, and Asher, as sensitive as a leaf in a slight breeze, would respond. There were too many things that she wanted and knew she could never have. Down in town, at the mercantile. In fact, the more she was denied, the more she desired. She suspected she was not alone in this, but whenever they went into town together, Some one or two of these precious objects would appear in the burlap bag that Asher carried with him everywhere. When they were safely at home and out of sight, she would carefully unknot the shoelace that cinched it closed and, smiling, hand her his booty. Hair ribbons, a set of ornamental pins stuck through a little square of velveteen, one the sun, the other the moon, made out of mock silver, a belt that seemed to be a long chain of flower petals in many colors of leather she had never seen before, green and red, and a bronzy gold. A farmer's almanac that told her the dates of great events, the Battle of Hastings, 1066, the frequent eruptions of Mount Etna, with the probability that there would be another within the year, and predicted weather catastrophic and benign, and warned, this year, that winter would be more harsh than usual, damp and windy. The little yellow book seemed full of threat, because it made no comment, only promised, in the very same print that recorded events already past. She had never mentioned those covetous yearnings to Asher. When they came to town, did he watch her eyes to see where they lighted? Did he monitor her breathing as it changed intensity in the presence of all that she coveted? Sometimes he couldn't even wait until they were at home to give her his gifts. At Doreen's mercantile, he would stand close to her, press himself to her side, and, below the height of the counter, she would feel his warm hand slip something into hers. The tiny cameo, bone white against umber, the packet of ice-white buttons, palm-sized surprises. One time, she lingered over a length of water-blue ribbon, rubbing it beneath her fingers to enjoy its silky gloss. And in what seemed an instant, he thrust a length of it at her, unsmiling, as if he were fulfilling a duty. Innocent-faced, silent, he was her little criminal, and she was complicit, and no one in the family paid them sufficient attention to wonder how these fancy accessories had materialized, or to ask to search a share's bag, no matter how lumpy. If only she could know all that he knew without studying, she would not need school. Asher was blessed, his tongue sweet without costly sugar, and she was cursed. Sometimes she thought he did not really exist. In the dead dark of the country night, lying beside him, listening to his sticky small boy breath, she feared that out of her own need, she had invented him. 5. And then it all closed in on her. Her mother, who should have known her better, abandoned her to an idea, and, already far from her best self, she had to fight to keep herself recognizable. Mother and her good friend Fredel became conspirators to marry her off. The boy was a recent arrival, Fredel's nephew, who showed up unannounced one hot August, having begged a ride with a neighbor who was heading past their turnoff in his wagon. With his eyes, he raked the girls where they sat in the two warm commons in relative undress, idly gossiping. Not that there was such a thing as undress, only the chance to suspend a few layers of bombazine and country cotton to roll up their sleeves and unbutton their collars. Chaya had pulled her reddish hair back and tied it with a rag, uncaring, though it was thick and usually rumpled, below it, her face surprised with its delicacy. Her gray eyes seemed to be influenced by the colors she happened to be wearing. Today, they echoed the blue-green of her wash-worn shirt front. Tomorrow, they might tend toward brown. Had she ever noticed that, she might have thought it an expression of her own irresolutions. High cheekbones and those forthright eyes wide apart and deeply set, gave her face a gravity that matched her darkest moods, like the one she was entertaining on this airless night. Some wild man from across the Caucasus, she always imagined, had ambushed her great-great-grandmother. She liked to envision him lifting her onto his horse and fleeing across the icy fields, and left her unsanctioned descendants with a vaguely Eastern cast. She did not think herself beautiful, or even pretty. In fact, she suspected she might strike some people as odd and hard to place. Though saying that to herself did not entirely protect her from vanity, she knew it best not to think about it at all. The nephew's move to America had actually been trumpeted in a letter from Fradel's sister more than a year ago, and now that he had finally arrived, exhausted from too many adventures, Chaya could see a dangerous look erupt like a sudden rash across Fradel's face. Rovin's Fradel was a milkmaid of a woman, rounded everywhere, pink and wire-haired, a sort of dray horse, sweet-natured but thick, and her sudden interest, which made her pinker than ever, was not subtle. How efficient it would be to fold this boy right into the batter, whatever he might or might not contribute to its flavor. He was a tall, pale, ghostly-looking young man. Shimmy. Chaya had the feeling that she could run the palm of her hand right through him, the way you could through a candle flame. His eyes were colorless, his skin the gray of fish, just slightly too long out of water. His shoulders narrow and sloping, apologetic. Something about his frailty made her want to pinch him. How could he have done the things he reported? Possibly, she thought, as generously as she could. He had been starving, and would, like a flower in dry soil, revive with a rain of attention. He looked famished for warmth and moisture, and for the sun, and there they sat, girls in their summer dresses, loose-haired, returning his gaze because they were so tired of each other's. Their lives had slowed to a dull drip. Nothing to look forward to. No temptations to regret taking or refusing. Bleak, bleak, Chaya was thinking. She who had loved the swaying grasses and the starry nights. Now the only excitement was the chance that, if you kept your head cocked back, you might see a dead star falling. Shimmy had been 5 months in New York City. He had had every experience, had found good work unloading wagons, been robbed and beaten, had shaken the hand of the mayor, had even seen Sarah Bernhardt, just returned from Paris. To the fields of Zion, these feats were equally miraculous, all of them. They who had been whisked past the city without a minute to see it or even smell it. Had they not spent a day in the tumult of Castle Garden and a night on a parched lot on the corner outside the building, a city of tents and shanties, while they awaited their orders and train tickets, she would never have seen the awesome variety of people the world contained. Women from the East, with coins dangling above their eyes, and those eyes blackened and sooty. White-haired children, girls wearing vests wildly embroidered with flowers and birds in violent color. Their fathers would not allow them to wander into the city, though they cried and begged. They were not allowed curiosity, which was dangerous, which was tempting. The mothers wanted to go up to Fifth Avenue, but they too were constrained. The women and girls were stupefied with envy, Their husbands and fathers had been bent on delivering them to green fields and open air, and forbade them even a day to walk in this wonderland that might have made the crossing worthwhile. It hardly seemed plausible now that Shimmy, this long drink of water, had so much life in him, such memories of dazzle and tumult. Maybe all he had was an imagination and the brazenness to lie. He told his stories around the table late into the evening of his arrival, his jacket off and his sleeves rolled up on hairless arms and flaccid wrists that hardly looked capable of lifting a cup to his lips. Unloading barrels off wagons? This was a puff of smoke, not a teamster.
Sarah Bernhardt!
Gittel breathed and leaned her buxom chest closer.
What was she like?
He answered in a quiet voice, as if all of it were too ordinary for comment, and shrugged.
Oh, she was nice enough.
His eyes lingered on her bosom.
She was more delicate than I expected of a woman of her reputation.
Either he was such a pirate of a man that nothing seemed exceptional, or just the opposite. He had no capacity for wonder. Both were repulsive. But here was the worrisome thing. Chaya's mother caught her eye across the room, widened her eye a thousandth of an inch, less, a little glint of collusion. A twitch of possibility so minuscule, she was not sure her mother would have acknowledged it to herself. But her daughter was 17, a bud about to open. She was fatally without prospects here in the middle of the alien Wisconsin corn, and she had become impossible to keep. Her refusal to work an affront and a mockery, from which no amount of opprobrium would budge her. And at their rickety table sat a landsman who seemed brave and honest, worldly but modest about his exploits, and, this was what made all things happen for a reason, wasn't it, beschert, destined, that he had happened to arrive among them just now and none too early, now and not too late. Her mother and Fradel glowed at each other across the assembled heads. Betrayal fouled the air, sharp as manure. The way things worked on the farm, if her mother suggested to her father that Chaya's future had just arrived on a passing cart, dusty but intact, not even a stranger, but vouched for by Fradel, and if he agreed that the boy had promise, she would not be consulted. There was no other girl, quite, of marriageable age just then. Gittel, for all that she was more zaftig than bird thin Chaya would ever be, was younger. So was Rachel. No one to graciously pass him on to. She envisioned this frail, leafless twig tight against her. The two of them in their own little room off the common, bundled under a quilt lovingly made for them by de Weber, required to lie close, required to breed like the chickens in the hutch. Chaya did not dare to think she deserved a prince, but she saw her body pass through his like that hand through candle flame, and she believed she would sooner throw herself in their stagnant pond than let him near her. She did not know much, but she knew enough, and if she shuddered, it was not because a sudden breeze had found her where she sat. There were no breezes there that night in the whole hellish state of Wisconsin. And then he winked at her, one of those pale reptilian eyes creased in a coy flicker of greeting, as if she had agreed to something, and she could feel her hands becoming fists in her lap. Suddenly, then, it made so much sense that she gasped out loud. Finally, she understood that she had been waiting for this. she was going to leave the fields of Zion. Shimmy could stay to inherit the stricken fields of hope gone dead. Good labor after bad, God versus Marx. If they had so little respect for her that first she was starved of the education she wanted and then was considered communal properly like Ein and Zwei, obedient cows, and their poor decrepit horse, an asset to be made the most of, she would inscribe herself in the debit column. Before she appeared as black ink in the ledger, she would quietly subtract herself. Let them write her name in red. And when she returned triumphant, a queen who could rescue them, let them try royal purple. When they had all gone to bed, she sat on the doorstep imagining a life. She stacked all she could not wait to leave behind. The cautness, like a dress snagged on a hook that bound her tighter every time she tried to move forward. She was too bitter these days, she could see it, to be kind to the children. She was harsh with the animals, short with her friends. And, ever since she'd been bereft of school, she had been a parasite on the community and a shrew to her mother. Everything disgusted her. They still lived in the commons, waiting for who? The Messiah? To build their own house for them. There was nothing here that was not chipped or cracked, soiled or deformed. Gouges in wood, fetid flowers in a jar, in green and stinking water. Eggs stuck to the wooden table, waiting to be picked at with a fingernail. Dust bowls, sour cleaning cloths. Mordechai's violin dead silent. Cow dung on her soles, yellow-brown in the cracks. Maggots in the outhouse. Coughing at night in the next room. Yonkel and his endless catarrh. The taste of milk gone slightly rancid. The distant taint of onion on every dish. She had read, half at least, of that Moby Dick that her teacher let her keep for the long time it took to make her way through its forests of new words and elaborate sentences. She understood perfectly why that man called Ishmael said when he found himself following funerals, it was time to go to sea. But, as if something had leaped out from behind a bush to frighten her, one idea made her chest lurch. How could she leave Asher behind? It would be a cruel abandonment, for her perhaps more than for him. For one thing, she was the one who had taught him to read and figure, and she loved it that he seemed to swallow books in one great bite. Now she feared he too would be conscripted as a pair of hands, a back, a shoulder, his access to books curtailed. His mind turned to practical matters, and none of that frivol and fuss they both so loved. She told herself, though she did not quite believe, that, being the boy he was, the lovesome, worrisome boy, he would object to leaving his mama and papa and the brothers who had ridden him around on the sweet, saggy horse, or pelted him, as they did each other. It was never hostile, with fallen apples. Now she had to trust his ingenuity, his refusal to heal, and believe he would manage somehow without her help, though she was not so certain of herself. She did not dare take one last look at him while he slept sprawled like a puppy in a litter beside his brother Beryl, for fear she would waver. Instead, she lay in the dark, clenched, listening to the breathing around her. Some even, some disordered, of far too many of her unbeloved neighbors. The next morning, so early the sun's red fire was just beginning to lick the dark side of the barn, Chaya stood in the way of Henry. The girls called him Horny Henry, when he came to pick up the milk cans to deliver to the railroad siding. Every morning, he propped them there to go to market on the 810. She had to seize all her courage to whisper her request to him, because he had always half-frightened, half-disgusted her. Henry was cruel-faced because of a brutal scarring he'd received when he was just a boy working at the tannery. In fact, the edges of his scars looked terribly like leather themselves, thick and brown and impervious as hide. And he looked as though he'd given up washing around the same time. But he was as regular as the sun that revealed the barn each day, and she suspected he was hungry. She surely was. So when he made clear the price for his assistance, she didn't hesitate to pay it. One fast swipe of his shovel-sized hands across her breasts, and one pretended thrust against her where she stood with her back to his shaking wagon. Poor Henry. She thought of the dogs in their barnyard hurling themselves at the yelping bitches. But he didn't steal anything from her, she reasoned, that cost her anything. She was still the same, a girl full of books and bitterness. When he was finished pressing against her, the first man ever to fit himself to her, mussing her dress. Her rough burlap apron must not have been quite the texture he had in mind. Cheap at the price, she thought, even though she knew she would have to yield this same favor again tomorrow, on the actual day when, her few belongings in a seed sack, she would hunker down invisibly between the cold, silvery cans that chattered against each other in the rank body of his wagon. Henry picked up the milk cans in a number of towns, and she asked him to let her off in Columbia City, which was the next town over, so that, if anyone came asking questions of the station master in Krista, he wouldn't have seen a girl carrying a sack stuffed full. She had looked in vain for the Gladstone with which they had arrived and had borrowed instead. $12 in coin from her father's hiding place behind the coming end of the capitalist monopoly, which he did not have sufficient English to make sense of. She stood alone on the platform. Columbia City was no metropolis. Trying to look casual, as if she made this trip frequently. Off on a visit, or to shop for things she could not find near to home, when, craning to peer down the track, she heard from behind an empty baggage cart,
"Hi! You left me!"
And out sprang her little brother, arms wide in triumph. He nearly knocked her over, diving at her. Here, to complicate her escape, was a small, short-pantsed boy, dark hair shining, knobby-kneed, vibrating with energy. He was not asking absolution for following her.
"Where were you going without me?"
His outrage was not child-sized. When he stamped his dusty boot, he looked like a petulant little man. Should she be angry or pleased that he simply would not be abandoned? However he had tracked her down, here he was as solid as Chaya, casting his shadow beside hers in the fresh morning sun. And so she chose to be pleased, flattered even, though it might have been the hope for adventure that had brought him, and not his need for her or his bone-deep love. From inside the station, a tiny, high-pitched bell announced the arrival of the train. A chair nearly leaped with pleasure as it crept toward them. Her own knees were watery. Car after car came worming out of the distance and pulled beside them far, far more colossal than she had somehow remembered. Heavier, noisier, obliterating the horizon. Brutal. Thrilling. When they had been helped up the high steps, the conductor picked her brother up and swung him right past her like a light valise, and took her hand with surprising gentleness, giving a little bow as he did so. Asher had found his first teacher. He tapped the man's uniform at the top of his dark blue thigh and asked about the silver ticket punch that dangled from his belt beside a tangle of keys.
What name is that?
The man laughed from very high above both of them, and they were off. By the time Chaya had settled herself and her sagging bag of belongings, Asher had the conductor in thrall and had sat tight against the engineer a while and, careening like a drunk, walked the length of every car. By then, in that peculiar way he had of staring at a thing as if he were a camera and committing it to his voracious memory, he had learned every word in the conductor's vocabulary, from Claire's story to sandbox to standpipe to trailing truck and coal tender. Asher's profile beside the dusty window was sharp as cut glass. His eyelashes, more lush than his sister's, were separate, as though they were always wet, his eyes and his nostrils black and comically round. He was this blasphemy? Like a boy in the funny papers. And every time he opened his mouth to speak, he made a little popping sound like her snap purse opening. It was the small noise, not quite moist, she would think later, when she had met more than a few, of a gourmand anticipating a morsel of something delicious. Her dual, no, triple, acts of thievery, abandonment, and kidnapping had exhausted her. She had executed in fastidious Yiddish a simple note that, contrary to every pleading by her consoling side, refused apology, and left it propped against the pillow, stuffed with their own chicken's feathers, on her parents' bed.
Dear Mama and Papa, I am not yours to give away, so I am going to hide for a while. Please do not look for me. I promise to keep myself safe. Someday, I may even make you proud. Your loving daughter, Chaya Liebe.
Then, like Jonah, who escaped into sleep at the bottom of the ship that bore him from Tarshish, Chaya hid from what she had done and, finally, from the knowledge that she could not imagine where they were going and how they would survive there. She had said, no. Yes was not something she could afford to think about. When, reluctantly, she woke to clamor and flashing lights, what she saw was the chaos of engines, freight cars, wagons, and cables. Thick and daunting, and tracks that scrolled to the left and right in a shining script that she had no trouble reading. They had arrived in Chicago, and no one would be there to greet them. 6. All they had eaten on the train was a piece of unbuttered brown bread Chaya had ripped off a loaf in the bread box. Why she hadn't taken the entire loaf, she couldn't imagine, unless it was some vague gesture of contrition for the way she was about to slip so secretly out of their lives. And a sweet the conductor had offered to Asher, which Asher unwrapped with great ceremony. Listening to the rumble of her hunger, she concluded that she was going to have to do for them whatever might be demanded if they were to survive here. This category was no longer merely abstract. She was a confirmed sinner, laying plans for further mischief, and they had not yet even arrived at the station. This, she understood, was why the doomed farmers of the fields of Zion had refused to persist in city life. They thought their resistance would keep them good. They stopped tantalizingly close to their destination and sat, and sat, and sat still longer in gathering heat while Chaya restrained Asher from rushing to leap off the train. Her legs had begun to feel as inert and heavy as fence posts. In fact, theirs had subsided right beside another train that was also stopped, and when, without a lurch, It began slowly to inch forward. She had the illusion that they were the ones moving. The faces in the other car seemed calm and peaceful. All those lives floating by in silence. Going away from Chicago just as they were arriving, and she was seized by a fearful curiosity. Why were the others retreating just as they advanced? Was that an omen? A warning that she might fail here? And take her a share down with her? But they might, she reasoned. These days there was a debating society toiling in her brain. Be going on a day visit, or to fulfill a family obligation. Why must she assume that because she was fleeing, they were fleeing? Then, with a ferocity that would have knocked her down had she not been seated, pinned in place by perspiration and exhaustion, she wished her mother were there to comfort her, and her father to let her lean against his shoulder. How could she not recall how different were his dusty, time-worn vest and jacket from the spruce outfits of the men and women beside them, and there in those passing windows? The hats. She could just see above the seat in front of her a spray of dark purple feathers and the very top of something extravagantly leafy. There must have been a virtual garden below it, combined with a rookery. She hadn't seen it earlier. Perhaps the woman had defied propriety by removing it for the trip and had replaced it as they approached the station. What would Pesya or Fredel have looked like in a concoction like that, or any of the women who never removed, in public, the headscarves that they trusted to keep them safe from a world of lust and provocation? She giggled at the idea. Mama, possibly. She had, or could have had, in a different life, a certain bone-bred elegance. She was tall, and her posture was proud, which sometimes made her seem unbending. But Chaya could see her in a hat like that. Though, under father's severe tutelage, she could hardly imagine her daring to want one. That was the kind of constraint that kept them ordinary. A crown, a brim worn up or down, she knew, expressed a woman's most secret self. It was practically an organ of the body, plain if her dreams were plain, abloom with life if she herself was vital. If ever she was rich, she would own a hat for every mood. They weren't moving. If only to contain her apprehension, she made herself concentrate on everything she saw. The shiny brown valise that sat on its own seat upright, like a child. The pull-down shade rolled up at her window. The gay checkered suit jacket of the portly man across the aisle, complete with a carefully folded handkerchief in the breast pocket, which matched the dark green of the plaid, but which, though he was perspiring in the stilled train, he did not use. He was, she was sure, what she had heard called a drummer, a man who travels with a case of samples and sells things far from home. Did his feet drum on the ground as he walked? Did he drum on the ears and nerves of shopkeepers or housewives until they surrendered and bought of his goods? There were customers as men and, undoubtedly less privileged, the backdoor men who wandered down their lane with their cunning cases of needle and thread and lengths of dry goods, and the occasional ball or toy soldier to make the children cry and wheedle until their frugal mothers surrendered. They had received one recently who clambered up in a wagon, and on the wagon, what did they find but the extravagant addition of a photographer's necessities? The children had convinced Mama that they needed a portrait, and now, Chaya realized with a little inner grimace, that would be their only record of Asher and his evil sister, more enduring and objective than memory. What she had come for was to entertain spectacle. having lived so long at the end of that washboard road where nothing offered color and movement. She admitted to herself, and proudly, she had come to be provoked. And if that meant that she left goodness behind, well, they would see about that. It was June of 1891, on the day that same kind conductor handed them down onto a little wooden footstool so that they might meet the ground gently. And there, in the late afternoon, she was overwhelmed with the certainty that they would be safe here in the province of strangers. In her inflamed state, it took little to overwhelm her. And this was illusion too, perhaps. But she felt the very rhythm of her perceptions change. So much passed so quickly that had it been music, it would, all of it, have been staccato. Her nearly weightless little brother pulled her along like a dog at the end of a tether. And then, what was their initiation into the city's strangeness but a real dog? Only a dog not restrained by any tether. As they inched down the platform alongside the great army green flank of the train, a dog as tall as a horse came running loose towards them and then, having nearly knocked them down, right past. He was the color of a bale of hay, but shining, and his tail ended in a long, elegant spiral. This was a rich man's dog. And when he got to the end of the platform where it entered the station, he stopped and looked back over his dog's shoulder, teasingly, with imperious eyes, to see if his rich man was coming. Still no one came rushing forward. He loped, then, casually, arrogantly, into the station, and when the two of them saw him next, he was sitting quite demurely before the information booth, his feet together, waiting to be caught up with. No rules, Chaya thought, which, of course.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.